Okay, so today's session is about the third stage of the presentation part, which is the impress, and which deals about the look and feel of the presentation. By the way, I have received some emails from people saying that they have not submitted their presentations yet, which is okay, because as I announced last time that you can go through this class and then probably polish your presentation. So those of you who have submitted already can resubmit it after today's class, because you may want to change certain things after looking at this talk today. So we are going to talk about the impress part, which deals with the entire look and feel. And although this may be a kind of very rapid primer on visual basics, but you may just want to add on to it according to your experience also, so you are free. Color has various meanings associated, and it changes from society to society. But here what we are talking about, the technical presentations, we don't have to really worry about the context too much, but it definitely has an impact. So while using some bright colors, be sure of what you are using it for. Is it conveying the right message you want to say? Because color will immediately attract attention for various reasons. It can be creating a mood, it can be expressing something, and it has a meaning. So people associate color with certain meaning. So very, very carefully you have to choose. Some basic guidelines: more the contrast, more readability. Like you saw on the top, the headline is gray. So gray and white is a low contrast image, so therefore you couldn't read it when the projector was not working well. But the black text was very much visible, whatever the quality of projector could be. So these things make a lot of difference when you are put up into various situations and you have not tested it. So you just go with a pen drive somewhere and start a presentation. Invariably, you will be unable to do whatever you wanted to do because of these issues. So remember these. Another thing is that for a room which is like this, which is brightly lit, everybody is under the same illumination, then use black text on white, which the thing what you see here. The reason being, if you in a dim lit room, like there are certain rooms I have seen that entire room is dark and only the area where the speaker stands has the lights. So in such a room, it becomes very difficult for the this kind of text, because this white area of the background really hits your eyes and you have to keep your pupils wide open in order to grasp all this. So it becomes a strenuous affair after a point. So normally for a dim lit room, use anything which is dark background and use white text on it or suitable colored text on it. The colors with lot of vivid thing, and now at least we are saved because of certain good quality projectors, the vividness is controllable. Earlier, if you probably have noticed, there used to be a bleed of color. So if you put a red on something, you could see the color bleeding out. Now it's slightly manageable. But more importantly, let's just check this. While selecting fonts, it becomes a kind of very difficult thing for certain people, for the reason that especially for neutral topics, you really don't have to worry about too many fonts. And one of the common mistake people do is using a script font in capitals. That is the worst thing to do. And most of the time, I see that whenever you write, even commonly made mistake is in certificates. And if it is IIT Bombay certificate, then you write certificate looks very good. And given from IIT Bombay, if you write that IIT Bombay completely in capitals in a script format, then it looks very odd, not readable at all. So think about the entire matter when you select a font. Don't think about a certain word which looks good. So for example, if I ask you which one of these options is the most suitable for the word military, the first one or the fourth one, which one will you choose? First one? Second one, okay. And if I ask you, instead of that, I use the Last one on the soft. How many people agree to that? Because that's a stencil cut and you associate this thing. But again, you cannot write your entire script in that stencil format because it only comes in capitals and your readability is really compromised after a point. So such things are very good for just the heading part, but most of the time use neutral fonts. Now, when you use fonts, remember one important thing, that computers and operating systems are not constant everywhere. So whatever you create, even if you create a PDF and you port it to some other operating system where that combination of fonts is not available, it will substitute it with some other fonts. And there will be some very bizarre font substituted which you don't have control on, and it will show up very badly on whatever computer you are using. This has happened n number of times that I am sure that, okay, because I have made a PDF, it should not ruin my presentation, but it doesn't happen that way. Most of the time, it takes a toll on this thing. So use very neutral fonts and check before you actually start your presentation. Another important thing is that standard set of fonts. Okay, standard set of fonts will be the one which will be installed in every system, and most of the time it's a very healthy combination of serif and sans serif fonts. Just to go slightly in detail, I think that day Professor Vaidya mentioned about this. Any font having this on the top, these two places, is called a serif font, and the one without that is called a sans serif font. So the H in this font will look like this, and on the contrary, it will look like this in a sans serif font. So these are two very, very basic types of fonts which will be available. Thumb rule says that for anything which is printed and to be seen by holding in hand, use serif fonts. They are more readable that way. So this is for print. But I emphasize, it is not for print for a longer viewing. It is for the book or a paper kind of thing which you are holding in your hand. But if you have something to be projected and seen from a distance, then sans serif font is preferable. And the reason is obvious, because you don't have this thick and thin, the readability is very high if you look at it from a distance. So that is the reason that you use serif and sans serif judiciously. Whenever you are put into the situation, choose either of them. Yeah.
See, what you are describing is a generic thing. So one observation is that it would necessarily mean that whenever I prepare a document, I must prepare two versions, one for print and one for projection or display.
Right.
Generally, what happens is if I prepare my slides, right, I take a printout of the slides. Right. So for slides, I have used sans serif. Then that is what will get printed. So I should prepare two versions to be ideally correct.
Ideally correct, yes.
Okay. Number two.
Right.
Sans serif and serif are generic names. What I think all of us would like to know is names of few fonts explicitly. So if you could prepare a list separately,
yes,
and circulate that will be more useful.
Okay. I think his question was that.
Yeah.
He wanted to know the names of fonts, but I started off with this so that you at least know about the classification first of all. And just to tell you two names of each. So for print, you have this very, very common Times Roman. And another variant which I personally like for this thing is called Palatino. So these two fonts are specially preferred whenever a serif font is used. On the other side, for sans serif font, the one which I prefer most of the time is Helvetica, but there is very popular font which is Arial. By the way, just to give you some backgrounder on this typography, when Helvetica is a very old font, it was invented in the ages of the treadle machine, where the printing was done using each character which was cast in metal, and the sentences were created by putting one character each. So there was no computer, there was no typing or something like that. So every character was actually picked up by hand from a tray, and a sentence was made, and that was tied up, and the impression used to be taken on a paper. So that was called a very, very old technique of printing. Helvetica was designed in that age, and Roman fonts also were designed in that age. But when computers were introduced, especially Microsoft introduced Windows, they wanted a font for both the things. So Times Roman they got very easily, but to buy Helvetica, Helvetica actually refused, and they didn't sell it to Microsoft Windows. So the designers at Windows told the typographers to design a font which looks exactly like Helvetica, but which is not Helvetica, so that they will just bypass the process of buying a font. And the font which was born was Arial at that time. And the story goes that they deliberately they named it Arial starting from A. So in any font list, it will appear first. And that is how Arial has become most used font in the world right now. And if you ask any typographer, in fact, I have seen applications getting rejected because Arial was used instead of Helvetica. So that is the kind of hate what typographers have for this font of Arial. Anyway, it was a digression. But coming back to typography, how do you lend emphasis when you want to say something in your text? So how many people of amongst you are avid readers of novels? Any novels? You read that? If you notice, novels will be printed always in one font, one color, right? There won't be any jazz about the, not even pictures. They just have text, pages after pages. And there is hardly any emphasis given in that. So maximum what they do to give emphasis, probably, they'll bold it or they'll italic it, right? So there are many versions available. So you can lend emphasis by making it bold. You can make it italics. You can underline it, right? In fact, that this emphasis of underlining was the only emphasis available when the typewriters were there. There was no bold font there because they used to have only one set of typing keys there. The only way you could do is that go back to that word and then press underscore a couple of times till you actually get that line. So that was the only way of emphasis. And another thing because of digital medium we have is to add color, right? So in a sentence, if you have one colored word, you can make it give the required emphasis to it. However, the mistake, okay. Color technique is not used in? Sorry. Yeah. Normal documents. Normal documents, yeah. Formal documents, you don't use color.
Yeah.
Yes, exactly. So you use all other techniques because you have to depend on the end user. They may not have a color printer. So they may print on a grayscale printer and this color will not show up at all. So you use the other techniques. The problem happens when in a presentation, so I'm now changing from document to a presentation, suppose. The problem happens when you do this. You do a bold, italic, underline, and also change the color. So it's overemphasized, right? You don't require all that. But I have seen umpteen number of cases where you have bold and color change, or underline and color change. So you don't require overemphasis. I think that story of what you narrated last time is an interesting anecdote. So, Professor Fatak was setting up a paper for CS subject. And that was the age when the papers were typed by the typewriting people at the office. And then it will be cyclostyled and there was no photocopying machine that time. So, the handwritten paper has to be given to the typist. The typist will type it and then checked by the faculty member, it will be gone for cyclostyle. So Professor Fatak goes there, gives that handwritten paper to the typist. Typist starts typing and he just laughs at a point and then continues typing. So Professor Fatak asks him, well, what's the problem? Is there something funny about it? He said, nothing, leave it, I'll just do my job. But Professor Fatak being a curious person like he is, he said, please tell me what is the whole point why you laughed at this. So he said, I'm sorry to say, but I would just like to point out one sentence in your paper. There are instructions on top, right? Everybody knows that for solving the paper. So one of the instructions read, use of calculators strictly prohibited. So he said, yes, I don't want them to use calculators. He said, I understand that, but can you tell me the meaning of word prohibited? So are there levels in prohibition, like slightly prohibited or more prohibited? Prohibited is prohibited. You cannot use calculator, that's all. Why do you write strictly behind that prohibited? It doesn't add any emphasis to it, right? So this is an example of overemphasis. You can use it very judiciously, but the moment you overdo it, it starts showing up very odd way on screen or on in a document. Okay.
Let me put it this way. There would be always individual occasions when different people will use different things. But I think first we should understand in general what should be our approach. In specific cases, different choices of individuals will always happen.
Correct.
Okay. So let us not generalize on the basis of a few odd samples that we see here and there. Our job is to understand what should be our general approach. So let us first discuss that.
Correct. And to clarify, I'll give you one more example. If you notice, italics is typically used in a peculiar condition of quoting somebody, right? So I said something like this, or he said, and then you put italic, or it's a in entire document there is a word from different language. For example, President of India has launched Swachh Bharat. So Swachh Bharat suddenly becomes italic because that's a Hindi word in an English document. Now, it's because that is a connotation attached to usage of italic. If you want to give something else, because it's not an English word, but we want to emphasize it in a different way, then you can use a combination of bold and italic. But because otherwise it will be treated as a foreign word entering into your English sentence or something like that. People may think in that way. It's up to the person who is designing that document to take their own calls, but it should be in tune with the normal reasons why people use different emphasizings. So if I use underline for a website, probably because it has become a hyperlink thing now. So the moment I underline something, people think that this is a website. So common example is the documents are uploaded here, and the here word is underlined, right? So you know that it has a hyperlink and you can go to that website. In a document, you cannot read that whatever that website was, because that here gets printed as it is and with underline. So what can you do with that? You can't do anything. So such things will matter when you use, and these are some of the, what you can say, some patterns which are emerging. So they are not very much cast in stone, they are just emerging. So generic guidelines are to use very, very minimum number of fonts. And also use font options to emphasize, but like I just said, you can leave it to you. One thing which I think I have missed it is in this, is use less number of variations in the font size. And this is important, especially in the presentations, also in documents, because you have excellent choices given by the word processing web softwares. So if you use Word or if you LibreOffice or whatever, will always give you that, like, what is the title and what is the subtitle and all that. Please don't try to fiddle around with their settings, because they have brought up to that level after a lot of research and lot of testing with users, what could be the title and what could be the combination of the font and emphasis if it has to be a subtitle. So they have done a lot of research on that, so don't ever try to change it, or even better, don't try to create your own. Use any ready-made template available and just go ahead with it. That's most easy way of creating good looking documents. The last point is what is missed by a lot of people of usage of grid. I have not seen many people even switching on the grid when they are creating a presentation. Grid is a feature which is available in every presentation software, and that helps you getting the alignment right. In fact, nowadays, the softwares are so smart that if I have this object and if I move this, like, you get these four dots here showing you that selection is happening. The moment I do that, and if I coincide with any line or any object within that particular document, it will show me the guidelines automatically. And it has a snap tool, so you can just leave it at that point and it will get aligned automatically. But a lot of people don't don't pay attention to this feature, and when it is projected, we can see that some bullet is going somewhere else and other things. Another very common mistake is a space after a bullet. So in 4 or 5 bullets, you can see one sentence suddenly starting after some time. Lot of people have seen, surprisingly, doing, and there are PhD students who have done that, of centralizing by their own means of adding spaces somewhere. So there are two lines, and you write one line like this, and then in the second line you keep space, 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 and write the next word. You don't require to do all this godagiri yourself, because softwares are meant to do all that for you. So because when somebody will copy this, they will also copy that spaces, and that will be very cumbersome later on to figure out how to delete them, because it is looking very bad. Okay, before we review your submissions, probably let's do, because we just had one discussion about color, fonts and all that, I wanted to show you a interesting case study. So in this year's Miss Universe, how many people saw this blunder? You saw that, right? How many people saw this TV grab? Right? So the paper in front of you will have a similar looking design now. Okay? So can you just distribute those papers? Okay, so for people who have not seen it, okay. So in this year's event, what happened was, the announcer was supposed to count in the order of 3-1, and when he was holding that card and he started speaking, he goofed up at a point and said that Miss Universe of this year is Miss Colombia, and he stopped at that point. And later on, he just realized, after he lifted his thumb on the bottom right, that it was not Colombia, but it was Philippines. And then he said, oh, I'm very sorry, and it is actually Miss Philippines. And literally the crown was taken up from Miss Colombia and given to Miss Philippines. So this blunder happened, but the designers worldwide actually took it as a very interesting problem to solve. So they, after looking at this TV grab, there was a common kind of a viral fever everywhere of all the designers trying to redesign this card, because they felt that the finger or the thumb coming at this particular point is creating the entire problem. So how to solve this? So they came up with some very interesting ideas. I will show that. Before that, you have to study this text, whatever is available, and the backside, which is blank, create your own card, which could be better than this, and which would solve the problem of this thing. Now that you have some primer on font and typography and design and all that, just see what you can do with this. So whatever is printed on the card is the matter which has to be there on the backside. You cannot delete anything, because that is the text required. Don't ask me what is 3-1 in right hand corner. It was there, so I just copied it. But probably they meant that you read from 3-1, but there is no number mentioned anywhere. So probably that was another mistake of design. So try to pinpoint mistakes if you can on the printed side, and try to solve them on the blank side. Okay, so the question is, can I add anything else apart from what is written there? Answer is yes. But you cannot delete any text on this. Because they were free to do more things than that. But they just did this much. That is where I think the problem was. So try to solve it by adding things. Okay, one mistake I can see a lot of. So try to write or draw whatever in the actual size. So imagine that this is the actual card of to be given. So whatever you are writing should not be like a small script written somewhere which is non-readable. So imagine the font size also when you say. If you don't want to write entire thing, you can just draw two lines of the showing the height of the font, and you can write that XOXO there, that's also fine. But imagine that it has to be, maybe you all have ball pens or something, so it may not have that weight, but you at least show the height of the fonts. Okay. So we have one here. How many people have similar design, by the way? Okay, the entire bench has the similar design. That is good. Okay. Anybody differs from this design? Okay, can you give that your design? And can you tell me the reason for that? I'll just put it. Okay, so this is a different design. And you can see the use of images here now. This was not done. And the reason?
Actually, sir, in the moment of heat, when you are reading, the perception of that people also let him judge that who is the winner. So before that, like when you read first in front of Columbia, then okay. You can easily mess up in the heat of moment that she is the winner. So right. You have to like differentiate between winner and first runner up. So images could help much in that case. When like you literally cannot interpret that, but like you say, picture is worth a thousand words.
Okay, so one easy decider is that you have these sachets, so they are not the winners.
Yeah.
And the person has a crown is the winner.
Yes.
So you show crown icon near somebody, then it's not confusing at all that who is the winner.
Yeah.
Okay. Also, remember that, remember the user. Who is the user of this particular object, what you are creating? The user is a very, very trained professional anchor who has been doing this anchoring job for maybe years now.
Yes.
And they are not somebody who cannot read, who don't know the processes or something. Still, they make these mistakes. And the simple problem which was cited was the thumb covered the answer.
And so one thing that a thorough research should be done that how the paper is like old.
Yeah. So the
instructions so that the area not, should yes. not be covered.
Correct. So the instructions were not given to the person to hold it like that. But it is so subjective that somebody will say, I will not hold it like this, I will hold it like this. Or you give me a stand and I will keep it there, I will not touch it. There was a case where it was like the Academy Awards, you get it from the envelope. If you don't pull it out completely, probably there will be something at the bottom. So things like that can happen because it is very subjective. And especially when you have range of people handling the same document or same design of the document, then there are things bound to happen. Okay, let me just go and show you what the designers worldwide have done. And let's see what was that. Okay, so this is by someone called Marco Leon. Right? You can see the use of light and bold fonts. So the bold one is very clear that she is the winner. And both earlier on are light, so you can do that. There is one interesting principle, by the way, which I see violated in this design. And you should remember this is another common mistake I find in most of the document writing. This principle is called principle of proximity. So what proximity means is, I know you know about it, but in terms of design, the principle says that things which are near each other will get related to each other, right? And things which are apart from each other will not have any relation with each other. The problem in this design is that the distance between the word second runner-up, USA, first runner-up and Columbia is equal. So everything is either equally distant from each other or ideally connected with each other. So I won't be wrong if I say USA first runner-up, because that is connected for me as far as the design goes. If there is a double space between these two, then they are apart from each other, right? Or even the font is different or something. So this is a standard problem which I have surfaced, especially when you have these paragraphs or bullets or something. So when you have a paragraph and a heading here, and if there is another heading here and the paragraph starts, so the distance between two objects which are not connected should be demarked very, very clearly. And all the word processing software will give you an option like add extra space after the paragraph or before the paragraph. That is precisely for that reason. So that you can really mark out separation between the two objects which are not connected or which are to be connected. Okay.
What if proximity is emphasized using grouping like this?
Yeah, exactly.
Like we'll boxes and all.
Show me that. So proximity can be dealt with using various options in design. But let me just show you one more design here. Right? This is what you wanted, right? So some designer already thought about it. Another problem here is that you can see the shading of gray done. So lighter gray, darker gray, and black. for showing the emphasis of the order. But can this be also a hindrance in terms of readability, because USA word is hardly readable now, because the card is gray, on top of that they have printed a darker gray, slightly darker gray. So these kind of things also have to be thought. Somebody wrote just like this. Just put text, second, I think this design was done by many people around, right? I saw when I was moving. Okay, this is one more. And this is one more. And this person said in his blog that why do people only think of black and white when it comes to the cards? You spend so much of money and designing for the logos and all that, and the big banners put up about this event. When it comes to the cards, they are only printed color on the back end, backside. If you see those award things, the backside is always very flashy and glossy. But the card side is always black and white, because they use a black and white printer to print. Now he says that why don't you use something like this? Because actually if you see here, they paste a paper printed with these words there. So he said, why don't you use color? Another person actually gave a direction to the reading. So okay, first read this, then go right side, and then read the second one, and then whatever is left you can read. That's also interesting way of showing. So I had written on my blog about various these things, and then I also put up one of my designs. So just added the numerical values to it, and then I had posted this. We had a long discussion about this on our blogs, all the designers who were participating in it. But just a slight digression probably, but probably this could have given you interesting points about designing as a... Okay, so the point for the takeaway for this would be about the presentation what you are now going to create and submit. Those need to be having these principles in place, these guidelines in place, so that we can easily see the difference in terms of how you have, what thought has been gone behind usage of fonts or color or anything like that. We have it on Thursday, so the lecture is on Thursday. Probably that lecture is about the second aspect of IMPRESS, which is once you have the presentation, what happens during the presentation. So there are also techniques about the, like I said about the lit room and all that, but there are transitions and the placement of things. So we just did a small exercise here. But in the next lecture, I would like to cover, because now that we are short of time for this lecture, we will take it in the next session, and the presentation submissions can be done after that. So you have time till next Tuesday to do it. So first observation, which is very important, is switch on the grid when you create the presentation, because that is very important and you can align objects properly. By the way, it is another digression, but let me just share how many people have used, because creating, graphs or any diagrams, flow charts is a necessity in most of the documents what you create. So how many people have used this tool called YED? Anyone? No? Okay. Then I am in the right class. So YED is a free utility. You should definitely check it out. What it does is it allows you to create a flow chart in the way you, so you can add boxes, arrows, and connect them and all that. But that is possible in most of the other conditions also. The best feature of this tool is that whenever you are done with your diagram, if you want to change the style of it or you want to create a finished output of that, there is only a, there is a button by just clicking it, it will create a very neat and clean diagram. So all these interconnections of whatever you have will be cleaned out in just one button, and it will just create a very good looking graph. Probably I'll just show you a 1 minute clip, which they have it on their website, because I think it is essential for all of you to know about this tool. There are many people on campus right now who use it after they started knowing about it. I'm sorry, the D is not capital. Y, E is capital and D is small. The website is called YWorks. It's available across platforms, and it's also available on web-based, so you can go up and try to see this. Okay, this is the website, and I just want to show you this. Yeah, so this is YGraph editor in 90 seconds. Okay, so this is the standard way you draw graphs, right? But you can just pull out an arrow and you leave it at that, it will get connected. You can type in whatever text you want to, change the fonts and all that. Now, you can also have these HTML utilities. If you have this kind of a spread or just a straight one, after this is the situation of whatever you have created, you say, sort it out in a particular format, it will be done like this. So, this becomes this or this, whatever you want to. There are categories of graphs mentioned on the website. You can choose whether you want a tree or you want a bubble burst or you want something else. See, this is that alignment feature I was talking about. So can you see that when it came here? Yeah, here you can see that these are two guidelines which will tell you that it is centralizing to this and it also centralizing to this. So that way the graphs look much neater when you present them. It can take comma separated values or this thing and also create a graph accordingly. You can export that into image formats, EPS, GIF, HTML, PNG, whatever. So, and then it becomes very easy to insert it in a document. So this is a interesting feature and very widely used tool nowadays. This is the magnifying glass option is also very useful because at times you create a very complex graph where readability is hampered and you cannot do anything more than that because the size of the bubbles is so small that you cannot increase it. So this becomes an easy utility. So I recommend this, you can use this, and in case you have a graph in your presentation for what you are doing already, then I suggest use Y8 to make that graph and insert it into the presentation.
There's a similar like diagramming utility in Microsoft called Microsoft Visio. How does it compare with that?
Proprietary versus free.
I mean, in terms of features.
In terms of features, yeah. I have not used Visio much, but I have friends who vouch for that and say that is very good. I liked Y8 mainly because I was introduced especially for data analysis, and because I work in the area of data visualization, I started using it. Okay, so to clarify, there is no compulsion of using only free products as such. I just go for it because I have been working in that space for a long time now, and I keep on trying to figure out if there is a
editable, modifiable, so that it can be further innovated upon by a larger community. If you use any proprietary product, then that proprietary editor must be available in order to make those modifications. Alternately, if a proprietary product stores documents in an open format, which is usable by other products. So, speaking from a software perspective, open APIs is actually the mantra of all software development today. And any proprietary product which does not offer open API is a suspect, however good it is, because it does not serve the general good of the public. That's the only objection, otherwise nothing. In fact, in the real world, you will always require open source software, you will always require proprietary software, depending upon what you wish to do and to what extent. The point is, most of the utilities, not just these, take productivity suits. Word processing. Majority of people, including all of you, do not use more than 15% of the features of any package. Are you aware of that? How many, you use Microsoft Word thoroughly? Everyone? Okay. How many of you have licensed copy, first of all? One. I am very proud of you. I have licensed copies. I have 3 licensed copies. One of them is an older version. So I cannot store my files on DocX and use it on my machine at home, because my machine at home has that license. And I meticulously follow licenses all these years. You should be actually ashamed of this. Now do you understand why we try to propagate open source software? We are saving our young students from doing a criminal act of theft. Do you understand what you are doing? You should be going to jail. You don't understand and appreciate that. Anybody who has any illegal software being used deserves to go to jail. We are not yet a developed society, but as and when we would be, you would be going to jail. But we are not even ashamed of it. We'll listen to this, we'll go back and start using that software again, saying, kya hota hai? Baju ka bhi wahi karta. It's an attitude mindset problem. One person in the whole class, one person who says he has this license software. Never, ever, not even once. You sure? Not even once. No. So that's the point. The question is of mental discipline. And why can't we, I mean, this is a course in effective communication skills. But one of the things that you would like to communicate about yourself is that you are an honest person. Won't you? And that communication is not done by words. That communication is done by deeds. I'm sorry for digressing, but let me utilize this opportunity to tell you, when I was Dean of Resources, I paid 45 lakh rupees to Microsoft to get a campus-wide license for all operating system versions, which is still carrying on. Do you know that even the operating system, Windows operating system, is a legally costed product? You're not supposed to use it unless you have a license for it. These are absolutely important aspects in your professional life. If you were to appear for an interview, and I am a company, let's say, and I ask you this simple question. Have you always used only legal software on your personal machines or departmental machines? What answer will you give? Or you will lie there also. That's the whole point. Please, and it is, the context was that, but that is the purpose. When you use open source software or free software, you are actually very safe from any legal perspective. You are also very safe from any implied perspective of cheating. You're not. You're being very honest. An attendant advantage of using such software is that any created document or graph or whatever it is, using such software is editable easily and legally in the hands of thousands of other users. I will tell you something, you don't need any detailed answer for that. Any proprietary product behind which is a huge lot of R&D and funded development specifically to improve features over competition will always have some features which are better than all other features. No open source software can match feature for feature any commercial product, because it has only a volunteer force behind it. A commercial product has a financial force behind it. And that is correct, because they are in business. They want to make money out of the products which they make. Absolutely no problem. Take, for example, MATLAB and Scilab. Scilab does almost everything that MATLAB does. But are they equal? They're not. MATLAB has better features. So this is a silly question. The point is, what do you want to use it for? If I want to use word processor to prepare a document for submission, how does it matter how great features a commercial product has? Do you require those? The judgment is to be based on what do you want to use it for. If you need certain specific features in your work very frequently, there is no choice. You have to spend 2 lakh rupees to get a MATLAB license. But if you are doing work which can be done by any other open source product, in a majority of your situation, there is no need to invest. And most certainly, there is never any need to steal. So you use the simple thumb rule. If you need something which is proprietary, by all means, go and use it. But buy a costed license, have a receipt of the money that you have paid, and use it proudly. If you can't afford it, then you have no choice. So, in conclusion, comparison between any commercial product and open source product is not reasonable at any stage, because commercial products will always have some features which are better than open source. But the judgment on what you use should depend upon what you most frequently need. And in case you just want to have, for the heck of it, that this particular commercial product has two special features which I may use next year, June. So I want to use it. By all means, go ahead. But pay money and buy a license and then. Because stealing and using a commercial product without a license is the greatest criminal activity in at least academically enlightened people like this. That should not be. All right. Sorry for hogging all your time. But so what I want to know is, for your graphs, actually that is a question I raised to ask, but I was diverted. What do you use what utility do you use to draw graphs? Okay. There are multiple utilities.
Yeah, there are multiple utilities. I just showed one of them. Even I think these slide presentation tools have a small draw option within that. Yeah. So you can draw in that.
The point is, for example, people who use PowerPoint, the PowerPoint itself is not a license copy. So all tools which come along with PowerPoint are also equally illegal.
Actually,
I will tell you, that is, when I was the head of the CS department in 91, when PCs had just come, I had made it a criminal activity in the department. Any student caught with using of illegal software would be debarred from all machines and servers for 7 days. And we strictly followed that. Can you understand, if you are kept away from machines for 7 days, it's a worse punishment than keeping you hungry for 7 days. But I would sincerely believe that as grown-up people, as matured people, you would put such self-imposition on yourself. Because if you don't, you are going to be the leaders of this country professionally. If each one of you does not practice what our friend here does, then I think we have no future as a nation. Please remember this. Very, very, it's more important, because this is the most critical communication skill. You are communicating about your honesty through your deeds. There's no better communication than that. There's no more important communication than that. All right, we'll conclude today with this. You wanted to just say...
Yeah, so we will have next class, which will be about the presentation, actually the process of presentation. And after that, you will be supposed to submit your presentation slides on Moodle. So the link will be open till I think Friday, Saturday or Sunday. Let's keep it Sunday midnight, so that we can discuss them in the next Tuesday class. Is that okay? Thank you.